and thank you so much for consenting to my invitation and also to come to be present here. And thank you on behalf of all the participants present here.
My pleasure, and thank you for being such an attentive audience and for all the excellent questions that you posed. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, I would like to request my senior, Soumita Acharya, from undergraduate semester 4 of our department to formally conduct the next session. Now, it's over to Soumita Ji.
Thank you, Shruti Sundar. Now, once again, I welcome you all to the second session today. Now, we have with us another eminent speaker, Professor Prasanth Kumar Das, sir, Professor of English, Tejpur University, Assam. Before I request Professor Prasanth Kumar Das, sir, to go ahead with his deliberation, may I request Professor Sibajyoti Karmakar, sir, to formally introduce Professor Prasanth Kumar Das, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Soumita. I feel privileged to introduce Dr. Prasanth Kumar Das, Professor, Department of English, Tejpur University, who has been in this university since 2001. He also holds the prestigious post of the Dean of the School of Humanities and Social Sciences. He had been a two-time recipient of the Fulbright Scholarship, which enabled him to go to Cornell University and Harvard University. He has presented papers in various conferences and seminars, and a number of his papers have been published in different reputed journals. His current research interests are in Indian writing in English, book history, the early English novel, and the missionary movement in Northeast India. Today, Professor Das will talk on traditional literary criticism. And I'm sure his lecture will surely provide illuminating insight on literary criticism as an interpretive process to weigh the social and philosophical value of a written text. Now, without wasting time, I request Professor Prasanth Kumar Das, sir, to go ahead with his deliberation. Sir, please.
Okay, thank you for that introduction. Very generous of you. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
You are audible, sir.
Yes.
Yes, all right. So let me go ahead then. I need to get this started. First of all, I'd like to thank the Department of English, Bankura Christian College. In particular, I need to thank Dr. Mukherjee, who has been in touch with me. I also thank the head of department, Mr. Arun Mondal. And yesterday I received a phone call from a young lady whose name I didn't catch. Reminding me of today's event. So thank you for your courtesies and for inviting me. I also see that your college has an A grade, has been given an A grade by NAC, and I think you're also designated as a college with potential for excellence. So I'm very happy to be part of this web series, which I think has been going on for about a month now. All right. Now, secondly, I've looked at the titles of the other speakers, and many of them are informed by post-structuralist and other theoretical perspectives. And I would have liked to offer a similar lecture, a paper, a research paper, perhaps. But then I was gently reminded, in fact, that the topic that I had initially suggested was Anglophone writing from Northeast India, on which I've done some research and which is a new area for many people. But then I was gently reminded that the lectures are for a UG and PG audience and ought to be tied to the syllabus. So then I decided that I'd speak on traditional literary criticism. But if you look at the schedule that you have with the titles, then you find that my lecture is looks rather odd alongside the other ones. But anyhow, one reason why I chose this topic is that I've noticed that students today read, or as we say, do theory very enthusiastically. Now, this is a positive development. We know that the first English department was created in India, in Hindu College, in fact, which is, I think, about 4 hours from where Bankura Christian Colleges. This was in 1817, and we know the reasons why that department was set up and why the syllabus was created. It was for reasons of political and social control by our colonial masters. Now, in the 1960s, something happened in Europe, which was basically a kind of widespread anti-authoritarian kind of movement it began in France. It also happened in UK, US. People were very young, people were very angry. And there was an expansion of the Western University, and people who had previously been shut out of universities, because the university has traditionally been a rather elite institution. Such people started coming in. And one of the gains of that is that we have now post-colonial, feminist, subaltern, and other perspectives. Indeed, deconstruction is and particularly anti-authority kind of reading. Rolla Barthes' famous essay, The Death of an Author, tells you that there are no authorized meanings. And the last sentence of that famous essay is that the death of the author actually leads, I'm paraphrasing, leads to the birth of the reader. So what has happened is English departments have continued in India, elsewhere also. But then we today read from our point of view, from our perspectives. And indeed, many of the lectures that you've heard have been from our perspectives, Indian concerns. However, I think because of the general enthusiasm for theory, or perhaps because of it, students, at least in my experience, are not as conversant with the basics as they should be. And so therefore, I have chosen traditional literary criticism to talk on this. And my lecture is not directed at the faculty who are present or research scholars. My lecture is actually directed to UG and PG students, because I think all the teachers and instructors and faculty who are present are really very conversant with some of the things that I'll be saying. But traditional literary criticism should be part of a young person's toolkit. If you are a student of English literature, it should be part of your toolkit. And so that is my reason for selecting this particular topic. And an analogy from the visual arts may be helpful. You know, Picasso is a wonderful painter, and he is responsible for such movements as the Cubist movement, abstract painting. But as anybody who has seen his line sketch drawings or sketches will tell you, he had all of the traditional artist skills. So he had his basics. So then traditional literary criticism. And of course, I should also tell you that this is Western literary criticism. In India, we have our own traditions. The Natta Sutra, for instance, is a very old treatise on drama. But in India, as you know, because of colonialism, our traditions are not unbroken traditions. They are broken traditions. And as a student of the English department, or as somebody connected with the English department, we mostly deal with English literary criticism. So that's going to be my area in this lecture. So I'll be speaking mostly about Western literary criticism. And that, you know, of course, begins with Plato. And if you were to do traditional English literary criticism, then the span would be from, say, Plato. Actually, there was literary criticism before Plato also, but let's say Plato. And then we end perhaps with the new critics who were active in the 1950s. Post-structuralism and all the other movements happened around 1960s, began in the 1960s, post-structuralism also. Till the 1950s, it was a different world where language was more or less stable. Our ideas of human nature were very different. I remember Virginia Woolf's famous statement that on or about December 1910, human nature changed. So this is a different world, and we are working with some different assumptions. Now, as I have said, if you begin with Plato and end with the new critics, then that is a huge span. It's more than 2,000 years, actually. And I really cannot fit in 2,000 years in an hour long lecture. So this is not an encyclopedic lecture, but I'm interested in some literary thinkers or landmark critics. And there are certain constant concerns which I'm interested in and which I want to talk about. So then I begin with Plato and Aristotle, maybe look just briefly at Horace and Longinus. Sir Philip Sidney, English literary criticism begins with Sir Philip Sidney. So we jump 1,000 years and we go to Philip Sidney. And then we'll talk a little about Dr. Johnson, and then we will talk about the Romantics, who challenged the classical positions of traditional literary criticism. And then end with Matthew Arnold, with whom literary criticism acquires a new urgency in modern times. But then I suppose you can straight away see the problems. Firstly, it's a list of male critics, dead white males. And that actually reflects the fact that women were not actually allowed to participate in literary and cultural activities until very recently. And you might like to recall at this point Virginia Woolf's famous essay, A Room of One's Own. So I'll try to bring in Virginia Woolf a bit later. But one of my regrets is that I can't talk about all the people I'd like to talk about. However, even this limited range of authors allows us to trace the trajectory of certain ideas and themes that were introduced by Plato, who of course is at the beginning. And what are these themes? Well, first of all, the idea that poetry, and they mostly talk about poetry, mind you. Poetry enjoyed great cultural prestige. Today, I suppose the novel is dominant, and we're more likely to talk about fiction. It's very noticeable, for instance, in post-structuralism, that most of the time when they're talking about text, they're not talking about poetry so much. In fact, it's rare for a post-structuralist critic to talk about poetry, mostly about fiction and texts, prose texts. So first of all, then, one of the themes that you can isolate is the idea that poetry should be didactic. Pleasure is not disregarded. In fact, someone like Aristotle knows that pleasure is important. But he understands, in fact, why pleasure is important. I mean, one of the strange things about, art, dramatic art or reading a novel, watching a film, is that it's all make-believe. So you see an actor and an actress on the screen who are very much in love, and you know very well they are not actually in love. Well, sometimes they are, but they're not in love. But it's very easy for you to sort of immerse yourself into this fantasy world that's been created, and a certain amount of pleasure is involved in that. Most of us would shudder if you saw blood. You know, mostly we are not violent, I suppose. But then we enjoy films where there is great violence, you know, and our children play games in which they blow off heads. There's a head count, and so on and so forth. In real life, you would not be so willing to countenance violence, perhaps. So there is a certain pleasure that comes from these things. So this is something that many of these traditional literary critics knew, and was something that bothered, for instance, Plato. Then the other expectation is that art should be true to life. In the classical tradition, art or poetry is mimetic. That is, poetry holds up a mirror, to quote Dr. Johnson later on. Poetry is expected to be reflective, to be a true reflective, to be a true reflection of art, of life. Right, and with the Romantics, of course, there is a change where it's not so much what happens in the outer world that is important. It is the poet's individual vision that is being expressed. That is what the poet should express. Allied to these are certain ideas, like Aristotle was supposed to have come up with the three unities, unity of time, place, action. If anyone who's read the Poetics knows that that is not the case. But in the neoclassical period, and particularly in France, this became a very strict rule. And Shakespeare was often criticized for not maintaining the three unities. And Dr. Johnson had something to say about that. So I'll come to that a bit later. Yeah, and one of the things that might surprise us, or is, you know, should not really surprise us, is that one of the reasons we read the classics is because they actually are modern. Right now we are in this pandemic. right? And you'll be looking to science to come up with a vaccine, and we follow scientific advice. We don't go out, we wear a mask, we wash our hands. So that's all coming to you from science, which is the modern thing. But then we also read, say, Campos the Plague. We read Oedipus Rex. We read Boccaccio's Decameron. So, you know, literature continues to, to interest us. And we, today's context is that we are in the current pandemic is the first pandemic of the information age. So if you read even Camus' The Plague, you find that there are certain things in there's some things that are not there actually in Camus' The Plague. But on the other hand, there are many things there. Like when I go to the market, I'm astonished at how little people care about, they disregard all the norms of maintaining social distance and all of that. And the reason for that is also the reason I think that you have, that, you know, is a starting point of your famous play by Oedipus Rex, where Oedipus the king, when people come and tell him that there's something that has polluted our city, the city of Thebes, and he orders an investigation, never imagining that he himself is the carrier, as it were, which is the same reason that you and I, or not, maybe not you and I, but other people that we see, people around us, tend to disregard any warnings, scientific warnings, because we can't believe that we are actually the carrier, could be the carriers of any virus or anything that is. All right, let me then begin with, some of you may be fiddling with your mobile phones because I have been taking classes online and also have a son at home. And I notice that often they're not, gets bored or something. I mean, you're fiddling with your mobile phone. Okay, if you're doing that, what you can do is go to Google Image and check out a famous painting. It's called The School of Athens and it's by Raphael, the painter Raphael, who was a contemporary of Michelangelo. All right, and if you call up that image on your mobile phone or on your laptop, you'll see that it's a very crowded picture. This is a rest painting. It's a very crowded picture, and it's an anachronistic painting because what you have depicted in that particular painting or fresco is you have a whole bunch of people there. It probably is what. It probably looks like what Bankura Christian College looks like when you don't have the pandemic. You know, you have your corridors and the people there, students sitting around and talking. So it depicts something like that. And what you have in that picture are some of the leading philosophers of the Western world. There's also a man in a turban in the side. That's interesting. But generally, they are the famous Western philosophers, the classical philosophers. So you have the famous geometricians and mathematicians and all of that. But in the middle, right in the middle, you have two central figures. And one of them is Plato and the other is Aristotle. Aristotle, as you know, was a student of Plato's. And like any good student, he didn't always agree with his teacher. So we'll come to that. And you also know there's a famous quote that all philosophy is a series of footnotes to Plato. Because Plato actually started the discussions. He initiated the discussions and people have disagreed with him or agreed with him, but he had the advantage, if you like, of starting off the debate. So Plato has always been central in discussions of what is poetry and what is art and what is literature, etc. So then the painting. What you have in the painting then, the two central figures, Aristotle and Plato. And Plato is interestingly shown as pointing upwards. He has a finger pointing upwards. Whereas Aristotle, in contrast, is pointing not downwards, but he seems to be pointing, his hand is level. So he's pointing at the world, as it were. And that represents the difference between the two artists, the two thinkers, the two philosophers. Plato was not a literary critic in the way that Aristotle was. Aristotle actually wrote a treatise on the genre tragedy, his famous Poetics. Plato never actually engaged with any literary genre as such, but he was a philosopher, and from his philosophical position, he criticized poetry. And As you probably know, most of you would know actually, that Plato had a concept of ideal forms. Now, I said that before Plato also they were philosophers. They were the pre-Socratic thinkers. Socrates himself was one of great influence on Plato. The pre-Socratic thinkers, and there are two that you must have heard about. I'm referring to the students now. One is Heraclitus, who famously said that you can never step into the same river two times because the river is constantly changing, and so are you. So you yourself are not the same person when you step into the river, and then when you step into it again, you're a different person. But there was also Parmenides. There's another pre-Socratic thinker, Parmenides, who said that the world only seems to be in flux. Nothing changes. And a good example of that would be the ceiling fan, you know, which is always revolving. But there's no real change as such. I think Plato was concerned with the fact that things on Earth tend to decay. Mutable. Things are mutable. And he had a theory of ideal forms, which actually spoke about timeless truths, eternal truths. So there you have a bit of Parmenides. On the other hand, you have a bit of Heraclitus, when Plato looks at the world and he finds that everything is subject to change and decay. Now, Plato's ideal forms, I think this idea of ideal forms works best if you think of mathematical forms. Plato himself gave the example of the couch. Or any other piece of furniture, like a table. So when the carpenter makes the table, he obviously has a table in mind. Now that is the ideal form, the table that he has in his mind. As I said, this works probably best if you think of it in terms of geometrical forms, because you can call up in your mind an image of a circle or a triangle, and then you can, of course, draw it on a piece of paper. But in a sense, the image that you have in your mind is probably more perfect. It's more perfect it's perfect in a way, let's say, than your drawing of the circle would be. And from this flows Plato's criticism of poetry and art, that poets, like a painter, let's go to visual media again. When a painter draws a couch, what is he doing? He is actually drawing what he sees in front of him, that is the couch created by the carpenter, which is already once removed from reality, from the ideal form of a couch. So what you have then is you have a painting that is twice removed from the real. Real here, R would be in capital. So this is one criticism. The other criticism that he had, and this was in the Republic, you remember Plato had a famous book where he imagined the ideal Republic, and among other things he was concerned with the kind of education young people would receive, and he thought that poetry was a very bad influence because poetry encourages you to indulge in your emotions, whereas it's more manly, and Plato was always thinking about male. The male citizen, actually, and the male. You have this problem then. But then he thought it was a bad influence on young people because instead of controlling yourself, you give vent to your feelings. And from Plato's point of view, that was not a good thing. Plato also has the allegory of the cave in Book 7, where he talks about how people chained to in a cave, they're with their backs to the world. And there's a giant fire, there's a big fire, and they look at the shadows that are there on the cave, on the wall of the cave, and they imagine that this is the world, or this is reality, whereas they are deluded. They only see a partial reality. So then Plato had Plato's philosophical view led him to make his notorious attack on poets, and he did say, as you know, that in Book 10 of the Republic, he said that he would banish poets from his ideal Republic. Interestingly enough, those who know tell us that Plato himself was a poet in the sense that he wrote Greek of a very high order, literary merit. His Greek has wonderful literary merit. And as this image of the allegory of the cave shows, he used figurative language. He used figurative language quite often. And now then, after that, we have the answer that was given by his student, Aristotle. Now, Aristotle, you know, we have these nowadays at night at 9 o'clock or at other times, you have news channels coming up with their, you know, talk shows. They invite people, and then you have about 9 or 10 people on your screen, and each of them is shouting at the other, and no one's listening to anybody. Well, that's one way of debating. But there is another more polite and I think more effective way of debating, and that is what Aristotle does in his Poetics. But nowhere does he directly attack Plato, but he answers Plato. Again, you know, some of these things you know, so let me straight away go to chapter 6 of Poetics. And you know that famous definition of tragedy, which you still use, even when we disagree. A tragedy then is the imitation of an action that is serious and also as having magnitude, complete in itself, etc., etc. And he says, with incidents arousing pity and terror, wherewith to accomplish its catharsis of such emotions. Now, here Aristotle is talking about the effect of watching a play. Plato was concerned with the detrimental effects of poetry, that poetry misled you. It took you away from the truth, and it was bad for your character. Here, Aristotle says something opposite and something positive. He says, you know, that that when you watch a tragedy, it has an effect on you. And what is it is a beneficial effect. Catharsis has been translated as purging. Not everybody agrees with that. It was clearly clear from the context that he thinks of the effect of tragedy as beneficial, as bringing you to a state of balance somehow, right? And there's another thing that he says in chapter 9, which particularly interests me, where he compares poetry with history. And he says that poetry is actually more philosophical, and that would mean more truthful than history. The historian is bound to follow or record events as they happened, but poetry is not bound to do that. And that makes poetry more philosophical or more truthful. Now here he's answering Plato's charge that poetry takes you away from the truth. Not so, poetry is more truthful than history, which is a record of what really happened. And at this point, I'm so happy to bring in Virginia Woolf at this point, because Virginia Woolf, you remember, has that famous essay again, A Room of One's Own. And there's a particularly famous part where she imagines a sister that Shakespeare had, Judith Shakespeare. And the point she makes is that if Shakespeare did have a sister, then that sister would eventually would have gone mad, because as a creative person back then, in the 16th, 17th centuries, she would not have had the opportunities that Shakespeare had. Shakespeare also came from not a privileged background. We know he ran away and he had to make his career in London. But he was able to do that as a man. Such opportunities would not have been possible for Judith. And she writes about the kind of life she would have probably led if she had run away to London, how she would have been cheated by men, impregnated, and so on and so forth. And then she would have died very young. Now, this is a complete fantasy on the part of Virginia Woolf. And a professional historian would never dream of giving you something like that. You know, because as I said, the historical record shows that Shakespeare didn't have the sister called Judith Shakespeare. But then, you know, this fantasy, if you like, is actually true, because remember, Virginia Woolf's essay has been very enabling, and it is in fact one of the starting points of feminism and women's writing. So it's a very empowering fantasy, and we concede its truth even when we know that it's not quite literally true. All right, then of course there are other things that he does say. Aristotle says, let me move ahead. That's what I'm interested in, on issues of representation, how far poetry or art represents life. So I'm concerned with those. You know, as I told you, there's certain constant themes that you find when you read these traditional literary criticism. So I'll very quickly move to now Horace and Longinus. Horace, I think, is chiefly interesting because of his injunction that poetry should both instruct and delight. So as I told you, our traditional literary critics often emphasize this point that poetry should delight as much as it should instruct. But then Horace also has a more practical approach. He's not theoretical in the way that Plato and Aristotle are. And unlike Plato, he has high regard for poetry. Now, his Ars Poetica is a well-known and much quoted, or has been a well-known and much quoted text. It's been quite influential in the history of literary criticism. One of the things he does say, which Ars Poetica is very famous for, is the idea of decorum. And decorum may be defined as discernment and use of appropriateness, propriety, proportion, and unity in the arts, whether in painting, sculpture, or poetry. And this later was made into a very rigid theory by the French and English neoclassical critics. Horace doesn't really make a lot of this, but one of the charges against Shakespeare was that he did not maintain decorum. And later on, you remember when Wordsworth and Coleridge started the Romantic movement, one of the things they were revolting against was the idea of decorum, that there is a certain kind of language that is to be used, not other kinds of language to be used in poetry. So the idea of decorum then is strengthened by Ars Poetica. And then you have Longinus's On Sublimity. Unlike Plato, who distrusted irrational flights of poetic inspiration, Longinus actually talked about sublimity and how to create awe, etc. And he was interested, like Aristotle, in the psychological effects of literature. Let me move now to Philip Sidney. And Philip Sidney is the first landmark text of criticism in England, in English literature. So far we've been talking about Greeks or Romans who have been influential, but now we come to Philip Sidney. And Philip Sidney, of course, is famous for his defense of poesy, which he wrote in 1579. But there's a background to this. And if you have it in your course, you probably know this. But so let me just briefly go and refer to it. Stephen Gosson, you remember, there's a man called Stephen Gosson who was actually a Puritan minister. And he published a pamphlet called The School of Abuse in 1579. And he dedicated it to Sir Philip Sidney. And in that pamphlet, The School of Abuse, Gosson actually made many of the same charges that Plato made. He thought that his particular target was theater, drama, and he thought it was the drama corrupted people. And Sidney was offended because he didn't agree with this. He himself was a poet, and he wrote defense then. And in that defense, he was drawing heavily. Sidney is not very original, actually. He is drawing very heavily on Aristotle. And he's countering Plato with much the same arguments. But what is interesting about him is that there is now a kind of Christian twist, because unlike Plato, Sidney wants to sort of say that, yes, the poet does imitate, but he imitates the ideal world, not the material world. And the ideal world that he imitates is actually the world created by God, So there is a kind of slight change in the terms of the debate. Moving to then to Dryden. Dryden, I think, is important because, first of all, with Dryden, we have a very interesting line, a tradition in English literature, where many of the leading poetics have also been poets. You know, so that includes novelists of say, by Johnson, Coleridge, Matthew Arnold, T.L. Eliot, and there have been others, you know. So we have this tradition of poets, also critic, and it's also been lost on the one of the arts of English criticism, right, even today, in constructionism, deconstruction, where you actually engage with texts. You're not just making philosophical statements, you do that, but then you also engage texts. So this is something that is common, you know, when Matthew Arnold writes criticism, he quote, and was in the debates. So there are attribution from text, and as I said, that engagement with text, what you might call practical criticism, that actually is right up to today. So there are certain commonalities also if you look for them. But of course, has a key place in English prose and criticism, and what I want to focus on is a particular state debate. That it's not enough.
Hello, sir. Your voice is sometimes.
That must be in a net problem.
Okay, sir.
Okay, I'll try to. Let me try to redress that. Okay, I believe my voice is cracking up. That might be a net problem. It's taking care
It's perfect now, sir. It's perfect now.
Okay, sir. Okay, and thank you for the feedback. Okay, now this is a quotation from Matthew Arnold. Sorry, from Dryden, where he says that it's important to respect authority, but then not to be weighed down by them. And this is important because later on the Romantics will lead a revolt against the classical tradition. So you can see this developing from Dryden, and on Dryden by no stretch of the imagination is a Romantic. But then he did make this very sensible comment that it is not enough that Aristotle has said so, for Aristotle drew his models of tragedy from Sophocles and Euripides, and if he had seen ours, might have changed his mind. So he had the sense to say that, and this was said also in the context of Shakespeare, because the charge against Shakespeare was that he mixed his genres. There was both comedy and tragedy in some of his plays, and this was supposedly against the notion of decorum. So, you know, and always, whenever I teach Johnson and I teach Dryden, I tell my students, it's very important that when you're trained in a particular tradition, it is also important for you to rise above that tradition when there is a need. You see, and this happens with Johnson also, particularly with Johnson. So I'll come to Johnson now. So Johnson then, of course, is a leading figure. And when we read Shakespeare today, for instance, we don't read him through the lens of Dr. Johnson. Dr. Johnson never read Shakespeare through the lens of feminism, for instance. Today we are interested in eco-criticism. That again was something that Johnson would not have an inkling about. But, you know, in his preface to Shakespeare, Johnson is a neoclassical critic for the most part, you know, and he has lent great prestige to Shakespeare. See, the earlier speaker was telling you how there's a whole Shakespeare industry. And Shakespeare has been very lucky in the kind of critics he's had. You know, people have championed him. And Dr. Johnson championed Shakespeare. He defended Shakespeare, particularly against this accusation that Shakespeare had no inkling, or Shakespeare did not maintain the decorum, or he didn't follow the three unities. You remember there's a friend of Shakespeare's, Ben Jonson, who was very proud of his university education. And Ben Jonson always maintained the unities and such as other classical rules in his plays. And Ben Jonson, you know, so you have Ben Jonson. And there was a time actually, for about 100 years after Shakespeare died, Well, Ben Johnson seemed to have a better chance of immortality, or that is immortal, than Shakespeare. Than Shakespeare, because this is the charge that was coming up against Shakespeare, that he was something, his writing is sort of mongrel version. You know, something wrong with it, with his writing. Maybe an untutored genius, but then not following the rules. But what did Dr. Johnson say? Dr. Johnson took up this issue in his preface to Shakespeare, and he said that it is all right for Shakespeare to mix tragedy and comedy. And why is it all right? Because life is like that. So the appeal was not to literature or to the tradition, but to life. So that's how Dr. Johnson put it. And when you read that part, Dr. Johnson, you know, is this profoundly, you know, confident man. You know, we know him. There's so many anecdotes about him and what he said. But there is, in that particular essay, I think when he's saying these things, you seem to detect a slight amount of defensiveness on his part, because he's up against the whole tradition, you know. But he does say this. And what happens thereafter is that what happens then is that subsequently, you know, when he says, Dr. Johnson says, it's okay to break the rules. If life is like that, it's okay to break the rules. When he says that, and when he says that there's no need to follow the three unities, you know, like Shakespeare has his plays where, you know, someone is born in one part of the world, then he's suddenly in an island somewhere. He said, it's all right. It's all right. And he said that people always know when someone goes to see a theater, he knows he's watching theater. And here again, I revert to what I said, that pleasure, traditional literary critics have recognized the importance of pleasure. And that when you and I watch a play, or when you watch a film, we know what is happening is make-believe, which is why we go along with the violence. In real life, you and I may not be willing to, you know, countenance violence. We are not violent people. So he knew this. He said people know, you know, that they're not watching life. It's not real life. So let's not be so literal. He said this. And because he said that, I think he set the stage for what was to come. That is the Romantic movement. Now, I wish I had prepared some slides for you. School of Athens, for instance, I could have shown you on a slide. And at this point, I feel the need for a slide because I wanted to show you that diagram, which maybe all of you are already familiar with. M.H. Abrahams, you know, M.H. Abrahams, the great romantic critic of our times, he has this book called The Mirror and the Lamp, came out in 1953. It's a book that is respected. It's one of the things you notice also in Western literary criticism, English literary criticism, is that some things are in fashion and then they're despised. There was a time when F.R. Levy was a god or a minor god. Today, you know, you would despise anybody who would want to call himself a Levyite. Okay, and the new critics at one time, they were the most sophisticated thing that had happened. Today, of course, I mean, who wants to be a new critic? So there is this whole scale rejection of the past. Now, The Mirror and the Lamp surprisingly has survived. As I said, it's a book that came out in 1953 and on romantic criticism. And I want to look at just refer to the title, because the mirror here refers to the classical tradition of mimesis. And what is the lamb? The lamb is romantic criticism. So whereas earlier, both are sources of light, the mirror reflects, that is your mimetic tradition, of poetry. But then with the romantics, what do you have? The romantic ambition is not to mirror the world, but to throw light on it. That is what is important now is the artist's feeling. The artist's vision is the inner feelings. And therefore you have that very famous statement by Wordsworth in the preface to Lyrical Ballads. Poetry is an expression or overflowing of feeling or emerges from a process of imagination in which feelings play a part. You know, and there are other phrases that he uses, the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. The entire emphasis is on the poet's feelings. And this is very important because what has happened here is that you have moved away from that mimetic tradition and you are now giving credence to the poet's feelings, his emotions. Again, I'll go to visual arts. You have sunflowers. You can take a picture of a sunflower, photograph of a sunflower, and then you have Van Gogh sunflowers. Van Gogh sunflowers are more alive, more rich, more vital than the sunflower we see in everyday life. We understand that the sunflowers that Van Gogh draws are from his mind, not so much from the real world. So this is, you know, though Van Gogh, of course, belongs to a different school. Nevertheless, it's useful for us to illustrate what is happening. So a different notion of what is art. But what is interesting is that even Wordsworth has a very high opinion of regard for poetry. In fact, he distinguishes poetry from science. Remember, the Industrial Revolution, the Scientific Revolution was happening around this time. You have the onset of these revolutions or movements. And in the preface to Lyrical Ballads, he does tell you that poetry is not the opposite of prose. It is the opposite of science. And by science, he means what Plato had meant earlier. That means what you see in the world, what you see in the world. Because poetry actually is visionary. Poetry is visionary. All right, then, I think I've almost taken up an hour. There are other things that we can say about the Romantics. We'll come to Matthew Arnold now, and Matthew Arnold is my end point. Now, you see, we cannot agree with Matthew Arnold. There are many things about Matthew Arnold that we cannot agree with. But one of the things he did was he gave literary criticism immense importance, particularly in the modern world. Now, Matthew Arnold was worried about the effects of the Industrial Revolution and society. He was also very conservative. I think around this time, what was happening was that the universities were again expanding. You read Jude the Obscure. Remember how Jude's tragedy is that he's not allowed to go in for higher education in Oxford or Cambridge. He's rejected because he comes from a working class. So this was the kind of world that there was, and this world was opening up now. More education and people were beginning to come into the universities. Suddenly there was an increase in readership. And Matthew Arnold, when he writes, he's writing for the newly educated, people who might read poetry, but not as academics. So he's writing about this for people like that. And he takes literary criticism very seriously. He takes poetry very seriously. In fact, he can see that religion is losing its hold. And he, as you know, put his faith on poetry, particularly poetry. Interesting that in the great age of the Victorian novel, Matthew Arnold does not talk about the novel so much. Another reason why, you know, you constantly have respect for Johnson is that Johnson, despite his neoclassical training, was actually able to appreciate Samuel Richardson's Clarissa novel. See, a novel is exactly that. It has no respect for tradition. It's something entirely new. But Dr. Johnson was able to appreciate it. In fact, he said it's the first book. If you want to know about the human heart, that is the first book. But interestingly, Matthew Arnold had nothing to say about the novel or fiction, not much anyway. And he put his faith in poetry. And he puts a lot of faith in poetry and culture. One of his books is called Culture and Anarchy. And in this book, he talks about culture as perfecting man. Now, later on, Edward Said would bring out a book called 100 Years Later, Culture and Imperialism. And Matthew Arnold's definition or view of culture is quite different from your view and my view and Edward Said's view of culture. So I come back to my beginning when I talked about Hindu College being formed in a colonial context, English departments being formed in a colonial context. For Matthew Arnold, culture was something that perfected human beings. He didn't see any problems with culture. He thought of it as essentially ennobling. But then, as you have seen in the context of Hindu College, English department, that very culture was used, English literature was used as a molding influence. You know, culture is supposed to mold you. Well, in a colonial context, English literature was created as a discipline to condition us, to form us as colonial subjects. So as I said, we come back to the modern period in which theory rules. As I said, that is a good thing. But on the other hand, you know, the traditional literary criticism still has much to say to us. And that is basic. It is the tool. It is our toolkit. And many of the concerns of the traditional literary critics are also our concerns. Today, particularly, you know, I happen to be the Dean of Humanities and Social Sciences in my university. And whenever we have meetings, the Vice Chancellor is always asking me, what is it that you do, your school does, or what is it that literature does? Because, and it's very difficult to tell him, because, you know, on the you are up against science, you're up against technology, and you are up against management. Students in management school are taught to run large corporate houses, to become executives. Scientists build bridges. They come up with a new vaccine. What is it that you're doing? Now, this is the claim that we can make, that poetry, after all, or when you say poetry, we mean imaginative literature. Imaginative literature is ultimately, it has a connection with the truth. It has something to teach us. It has certain effects on us. And it's serious business. So thank you very much for your patience. I hope I've not been too obvious, because many of the things that I've said are well known. And if you have any questions at this point, I would be happy to take them.
Thank you so much, sir, for this illuminating lecture. Now may I request Dr. Nadugopal Mukherjee, sir, to conduct the interactive session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Soumita. Am I audible? Perfectly audible?
Please. Oh, yes, yes, I can hear you. Yes, please, go ahead.
Thank you, Soumita. Now the virtual platform is open for all kinds of questions, interactions, observations. And I must tell you here, all the audience, all the participants here, that immediately after this interactive session, we will have a feedback session. Dr. Antara Mukherjee, Dr. Sarbani Banerjee ma'am, such resource persons are there who earlier spoke on other days. So they would be giving some kind of feedback, and also we expect some kind of feedback from the students also, because this is the penultimate day, you all know. And so the web lecture series that started on the 20th of the last month and ending today, at least for the time being, it is ending today. We don't know what we'll be doing in the future if this situation continues. But this particular series at least comes to an end today. And so we would like to have some kind of feedback from our students also, and from the research scholars, earlier our students, formerly our students. So we expect some kind of feedback from them also. So please wait after this interactive session, wait for the feedback session. Also, that will be followed by the vote of thanks, official vote of thanks to be given by, to be proposed by our head of the department, Mr. Oyan Mundal, Professor Oyan Mundal, sir. So please, I request all the participants here to please wait till that point of time. And now, as I said, you can ask your questions directly to Professor Das, or you can put forward your questions in the chat box, and I will read out the questions on your behalf. So either of the two. Let me check if there is any question right now for you. So I have a question for you.
Yes, please.
What was really the necessity of this switch over from literary criticism to literary theory? Even though we know some obvious reasons, still for our students at least, if you could give some response to that, some kind of response to that. Why was there was such a switchover, such a shift in paradigm from literary criticism to literary theory in the early 20th century?
Oh, yes, because one of the things we see before the onset of theory is that we had people like Samuel Johnson, Coleridge. So you had an occasional critic. Now what you have is an explosion of theory. See, we have become theory departments. One of the reasons is that, of course, one, you know, Freud, for example, Sigmund Freud, he was working in psychology. But then we found his theories very productive for the interpretation of literature. So that's how we went to, you know, our discipline began to incorporate psychological interpretations. So sometimes when people work in other disciplines, it can be productive for you in English literature. Similarly, Marx's ideas have been introduced to English literature for the interpretation of English literature. But I agree with you that there was a certain explosion, a certain turn with the coming of structuralism first and then post-structuralism and all of the rest that happened after that. What you have is basically the application of a particular linguistic model, that is the Saussurean linguistic model of structuralism, that became widely applied by Derrida, by Foucault, to different disciplines. And at what point does a particular theory in a particular discipline, say in anthropology, Claude Levi-Strauss is an anthropologist. So at what point did his theory or his writings become important for English departments? When did the crossover happen? I think at that point when it was found that some of his insights could be applied very fruitfully to the study of literature and text. So that's one explanation. The other explanation is, as I said, there was this revolt in the 1960s, the hippie movement, the counterculture in Paris in 1968, widespread riots. And Derrida, Foucault, Roland Barthes are actually products of that. And what you have is a rebellion against established ways of reading. And you have a new idea, for instance, the idea of human self. You know, I think of myself, even today, for most of us, it's very difficult to function without this idea that I am an independent person. You know, that when I take a decision, the decision whether I will listen to the rest of the discussion here or leave, you know, that is very much my individual decision. And I think of myself as an independent person who can take a decision. Now, even this idea of the self has been challenged. So you have a new idea of human nature. You have a new idea of language. You know, the idea that language is, the meanings are constantly differ, meaning language is instable. So partly it's also because such ideas have come and created a revolution in the way we look at texts. So English departments have changed, and there are different points. I mean, post-colonialism, for instance, that come, you know, is connected to, but that's another of the points at which, you know, you start looking at literature from your perspective. So all of this, and I think feminists, women have always, have never been allowed to read in the way they want to. Now they are asserting themselves. So, you know, with the expansion of universities, expansion of the, not only in terms of faculty, but also in terms of students, I think there's a whole climate now. The climate is very, very different. It's an entirely different climate.
Thank you so much, sir. After
1960s. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. And is there any other question from anyone?
Yes, sir. I think Hasnat has a question.
There is a very basic question.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
What is the importance of literary?
I was looking at that, Hasnat. And this is a very difficult question. It's a very basic question, literary question. What is the importance of literary criticism? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's very difficult to answer this. I encourage students to ask this question, but it's also a very difficult question to answer. What is the importance of literary criticism? Literary criticism, basically, evaluation, is it not? I mean, why is Shakespeare important? Why people speak to you and somebody else may not speak to you? It can be a case where when a valued author, or in my case, an assumed author, probably I don't feel as close to that author as you may feel as close to Shakespeare. It's quite an individual response. And literary criticism is also, you know, asking questions about some of the questions that we look at today, that literature matter at all, right? So the more philosophical questions also. So there is, and you know, Orwell has an essay in which he tells you that literary criticism probably there from the beginning. You know, be something that literary criticism came afterwards, that the Greeks did their writing, Sophocles is detecting with there being a kind of literary criticism industry. He says not so. In fact, writing, and in fact, the process of creation itself, as you write a line and you cross it out, you're writing a poem, say, and you're not satisfied with a particular line, what is happening is literary criticism. You're evaluating your own work and you're saying that this is not good enough, I need to do this better. So that there is a kind of evaluation there. So, you know, literary criticism, and that's why there's a reason I suspect also that one of the things that I mentioned in my talk is that many of the leading critics in English literature have actually been poets, practicing poets. And T.S. Eliot himself said that his literary criticism was a product of his left hand, implying that the right hand he wrote poetry, and this is a kind of byproduct of that. So literary criticism is all of these things. And but I would like to also stress that today we are reading for ourselves. You know, when I was looking at some of your the titles of some of the talks, I was saying that, okay, I missed an opportunity because I also have certain things that I want to say, some of my research that I would have liked to share with you. Because, you know, what's happening is people are reading from their particular individual standpoints, right? So many of the topics that you had today were almost called like cultural studies topics. So that's another thing that's happened in English literary studies, where you are now not just the Department of English Literature, you're also doing a kind of cultural studies when you're going to film studies, for instance. You know, all of these things are happening, and it's all important because you are evaluating work that comes out or work that has been there. And it's a constant process because there are some writers who are very famous earlier, George Meredith. You don't read him anymore. You don't read, Virginia Woolf had some very damaging things to say about Anthony Trollope and other novelists in her essay called Modern Fiction. And we have accepted that. There may be a reevaluation of these writers. In fact, during this period, I was reading some of these writers who you've neglected. A wonderful writer called Elizabeth Gaskell. We don't read. You know, English departments don't usually have her in the course. So literary criticism is also this, where you're constantly evaluating, and then next time, maybe when the course is designed, you might bring in, you know, in my case at least, Elizabeth Gaskell. So yeah, so it's all of these those things. A very important question.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. And this is from Siri Gupta. You find the question there, sir. Can you explain the terms?
ME.
Poesis. Yeah. Siri Gupta. Can you explain the terms poesis, poema, and poeta in Ars Poetica?
Poesis. In Ars Poetica.
Yeah.
These are actually Latin terms, poesis, poema, and poeta. I really can't tell you I can't give you a very nuanced answer to this because I've done my reading of Ars Poetica in English translation.
Okay.
English translation. Yeah. And I know there's a certain amount of scholarship that deals with the use of the word mimesis, for instance, in Aristotle. But in the case of Ars Poetica, I'm sure there is a certain amount of scholarship that explains the difference between these terms. I'm sorry, but I'm not the person to explain that. I really don't know.
Okay, sir. No problem. And then, Ayun, should we move on to the next session now?
Yes, sir. Please do. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, Professor Prasanth Das. In spite of your busy, hectic schedule, you decided to, or rather you agreed to address the audience and to come to the help of the students. Thank you so much. Now I go back to...
Thank you for inviting me.
Soumita, are you there?
Right. Thank you so much.
Sir, hello, Dr. Mukherjee.
Yes.
I request you to begin the feedback session officially. Yes.
Okay, thank you so much, Ayun, for giving me this opportunity. So we started our web lecture series, as I said earlier, and you all know, on the 20th of June, that is in the last month, with our inaugural lecture, rather a kind of interview, where Professor Kunal Basu, the eminent writer, and Dr. Gupta from Vishwabharati they participated. With that particular interview session, we started our web lecture series. And thereafter, we found a series of distinguished, eminent, highly resourceful teachers who addressed here on the virtual platform and who have been kind enough, generous enough to address our students, to address the problems that our students are facing in this pandemic situation. We are really thankful to grateful. We are thankful, grateful to all of them. And we have now come to the last part of this lecture series. That is now the feedback session and also the official vote of thanks. So let's start that session. And first of all, I would request our revered resource person today, who is present here also, Professor Prasanth Das, to say a few words of encouragement for all of us, not only for the students, but for the research scholars, for the faculty members, and for all kinds of people, the academia, right in this pandemic situation. And if you could say something as a kind of encouragement for all of us.
Well, thank you for giving me this opportunity, and I'll be brief. One of the things that we have done, I think the faculty in our country has done, is that we have maintained some kind of continuity through this technology that we now have. And I think you've made a very, very concerted and sustained effort, because this has gone on for a month. And I'm sure there's a lot of planning and getting in touch with people. You know, there's a certain amount of organizing that you have to do. But you have done that because as teachers, you believe that there should be some continuity. You know, obviously, there's no substitute for classroom teaching. In my university, we did a survey recently. One of the interesting things that has emerged is that students are now saying that we want to go back to the traditional classroom, and that nothing was better than the traditional teaching. Nothing is better than the traditional teaching. I myself joined online classes in March. Some things were new for me. I quickly learned, as did my colleagues, and we have been delivering our lectures online. Now, there was a lot of pressure on faculty prior to the COVID-19 situation, where we were constantly being told that go online, the university of the future will be a digital university, and you will be moving away from the physical university. We were being told all that. One of the good things about the pandemic is at least it's kickstarted that process. But then we also see the limits, because I don't know what the situation in Bengal is, but in Assam right now we have floods. Even in normal times, internet connectivity is a big issue. Then you have students who do not have laptops. Some people do not have Android phones. And every time I take a class, I'm disturbed by the fact that out of a class of 60, there are maybe 34. You know, and from a teacher's point of view, that represents failure, because you are not able to bring those others into your class. So there are these issues, but nevertheless, in a very difficult situation and a very unprecedented situation, it's never happened like this before. Universities have kept it going. Universities and colleges have kept it going. In fact, in my university, currently, we are in the middle of exams, and it's been 100% attendance. Students have made a great effort. It's not only faculty that makes an effort. Students have made a great effort. I know a student whose house is under flood water. He has moved to a neighboring town, hired a house, but he's still appearing for the exams. So students are also making an effort. All right. So we are doing this, and I'm so glad that your university, your college, is doing this. As I said, I did a quick Google kind of survey, and then I found that you are an A-grade institution. You are also a center for with potential for excellence, a college of with sort of potential for excellence. So there's a greater responsibility on you, and I think you've discharged it from whatever I can see. I think you've discharged it because I've heard of people. I've seen university departments or college departments organizing a day-long webinar. But you have sustained it over a month. And that's therefore, because I'm also an administrator, not just an academic, that's partly the reason why we very well to present a research paper, but then that. Thank you. And I truly appreciate, as someone in administration.
Thank you so much, sir. Actually, as you were referring to, we secured A position, A grade, in the third cycle in the last year, in the revised format, in the new format. And coincidentally, I was the coordinator of the IQAC of that time, and Mr. Okay. Ryan Goldwell was also there, our head of the department now. He was also an important okay. member of that IQAC team. And it was joint effort in the last two cycles, in fact, second and third, both the cycles, we had A grade. And as you know, our college was established in 1903. And since then, it has to its, what I should say, it has got too many, it has secured so many achievements, earned so many things in the last 118 years. So many feathers have been added to what I would say, its cap. And so because of the untiring efforts of the faculty members, and in our institution, we can really be very proud of the regular attendance of the students. Most of the students in our institution have more than 90% attendance in the classes, regular classes I'm saying, not really on the virtual platform. So when we found that this pandemic situation really created problems for all of us, for the students as well as for the teachers. From teachers' perspectives, we decided to go for, from teachers' perspectives, we were rather really sad, unhappy over the what the situation that the students had been facing. And so we decided to go for this kind of lecture. And we are really thankful to you also, all the resource persons who came, appeared on the virtual platform and did something for our students, not only for our students, but also for the students from other academic institutions across the nation. And also we had also some foreign speakers, mainly two speakers from the UK, who also agreed to deliver lecture for our students. We are thankful to all of them. Anyways, our head of the department is there for official vote of thanks, for proposing the official vote of thanks. We will go to that part later on. But right now we have with us again, Dr. Sarbani Banerjee Mukherjee, our very beloved Sarbani Di, who has been following us all along and has remained present in almost all the sessions, except one or two, when she herself was a resource person for other colleges or institutions. Other than those few sessions, she has been there with us all the time. So now, Sarbani Di, could you say something for our students and also for us?
Thank you so much, Professor Mukherjee, for giving me this opportunity to share a few thoughts that has been circling within my mind for these few days. First of all, I would like to say, shout out for Bankura Christian College. Number one, that this has been a very long session of talks, and you have, I have seen you, Professor Oyon Mondol, and so many other of your faculty, your students, you know, working tirelessly. And every single day you have brought along some exceptional speakers. And I can well understand the amount of time and effort and attention, phone calls, messages, emails that goes behind the arrangement of such a, you know, long, elongated process of webinars. So hats off, salute to all of you, number one. Number two, what I noticed, which I did not find anywhere else, was the wonderful way in which you involved the students in the, the presentation part, introduction part. And I could see the confidence building in those little young faces as they very confidently, very smartly, I mean, who says that Raniganj and Bankura are in the Mufassil? This is the time when we are, you know, sort of conquering the center with our hard work. So they from, I can see students from UG semester two, semester four, PG students, they have all rallied around you. And this must be the work and the inspiration of the teachers, because without their inspiration, these students could not have performed in such a way. So thank you so much. And last but not the least, thank you for inviting me to speak in this, you know, star-studded galaxy. I feel very honored and very, very humbled to get the amount of love and attention that I have received from the Department of English. I am truly indebted. And today the grand finale could not be better. I thank Professor Dash because, you know, he brought us, I have been teaching English for so long, and I am not ashamed to say that I am a bit of a classicist. I do also read culture studies, post-colonial studies, and all the modern genres that are in practice. But give me classics any day, and I was enthralled by your presentation because it took us back to where we actually belong. So Shakespeare and literary criticism was, I think, the cherry on the cake that Bankura Christian College presented to all of us. Thank you so much for your wonderful paper, sir, and thank you, Professor Mukherjee, for allowing me this opportunity to express my happiness and my gratitude. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sarvanidhi. What could be better than that? So this kind of encouragement and motivation for all of us. Thank you so much. And you have been always with us, whatever be our needs. You have always been there with us. Thank you so much. And we also enjoyed
my pleasure.
One of the best lectures that we had. Okay, Sarvanidhi, one of the best lectures we could have.
Thank you so much. You are very kind.
Yeah. Another issue person. And again, I must say, we are also thankful, grateful to her, Dr. Antara Mukherjee. And she has been rigorously present. And a genuine scholar, you all know, Dr. Antara Mukherjee, right now in a government college in Kolkata, Iqbalpur. Government General Degree College. And she has been following us again for all these days, except one or two sessions. She has been present all along with us. And on her day also, we know the kind of lecture, the quality of lecture, the research that she had behind that lecture. We must appreciate that. And on a personal note, she told me, she took 22 days. She studied for 22 days just to prepare herself for that lecture. Look what amount of research was there behind what she said. So these are those quality lectures that we must really salute, we must really appreciate from the core of our hearts. Thank you, Dr. Antara Mukherjee. And now I would like to request you to say something in the form of encouragement for our students and also for us.
Dr. Antara Mukherjee, yes.
Am I audible and visible? Okay.
You are.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Das because. Like Sarvanidhi, I am also a classicist by heart, and I truly appreciate the way he addressed students. And it is so, so important, to go back to this, to these areas, and lest we should not, we forget these areas, because somehow we are all theory driven nowadays. Extremely driven to the point of being mad. So, but we should always remember where it all began. And I was recollecting my PG times as a student, reading Coleridge and Dryden and all Shakespeare on stage and all those things. So thank you very much, Professor Das, for that lecture today. Now, for me, this entire web series has been one of an experience because, as I said, when I was supposed to deliver my lecture, that it provided me a scope to rub off my rust. I was literally rusting, and as this pandemic was beginning to grow upon me, and we were like swayed by different types of academic and household responsibilities. It was very difficult for me to balance, to gain my balance as a person. But this web lecture series, where we find not only the teachers and the students coming in, joining their hands, but also I'm so glad that the guest faculties of the department, they are up on their toes. They are met to feel as a part of the department, along with the students and with the faculties. And this is something which I really appreciate. This shows the culture of a department that doesn't actually believe in hierarchy. And maybe because of this, speakers, notable eminent speakers, have been introduced sometimes by the students, sometimes by the guest faculty, sometimes by the head, sometimes by seniors like Palda. So it has really been a proper mosaic space for a department to run this webinar so efficiently. More or less, Chaudhary has summed up things for all of us on behalf of all of us. All I can say is a personal note of thanks for the opportunity that I was given to deliver a piece or something like that on Makbul. And I would also like the department to continue this, to bring back DNB sir, who is we'll get to finish in the virtual Jana sir, because I'm really looking forward to these two lectures, which unfortunately couldn't happen due to unavoidable circumstances. So my request to the department would be to arrange these two talks as fast as possible so that this continues. Bakura Christian College, it has almost become my habit to finish up my cooking right early in the morning and to log in at 11. So this, I don't know whether this has been a good habit or a bad habit, but it has become a habit. And I would like to, you know, get more sleep from you in this way. As far as the students are concerned, and basically for whom this lecture was addressed to, these sessions were addressed to, for me, right from my batch, I have seen students from Bakura Christian College doing exceptionally well. To me, it's not a surprise because, you know, I have been brought up in a Mofuscal town, knowing and acknowledging the value and the standard of students from the Mofuscal. I have myself, you know, I have never felt this kind of margin-center binary because who makes the center, who makes the margin, is something which is which I cannot understand. But students from Bakura, students from Purulia, Vishnupur, Shonamukhi, and the entire world, they have been fantastic. I've been in every profession that you can think of. So for me, getting good questions from students, getting good feedback from students, even Facebook friend requests from students has been an honor. And I look forward, as I said, to see you all shining in your own field, liking, you know, doing what you like to do. You can venture out, you can spread out your wings, you have wonderful mentors to back you all. And if at any point of time there is any requirement, then of course we are there. So all the best, and see you soon, maybe. Bye. Thanks, Naruda, and thanks, Arun, for the honor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Antora, for your kind words. And really, our students, our assets, and you have, as you rightly pointed out, every day we have some new students to host the sessions or to propose the vote of thanks. Sometimes we also go for vote of thanks, but usually we give the responsibility to our students. And you all know our students are really our pride. And even in the past also, even when we had our regular classes, even in those days, our students were quite confident in giving seminar talks or in going to the classrooms as teachers to teach the juniors. This is our regular practice, and this what actually these are the things that we do for confidence building of the students. And our students have never let us down. And this is the series, at least this is the series where we have found that they have excelled themselves, and some of them even have performed better than us, at least I would say better than me. they have performed better than me. And this is really going to be our, these are going to be really our moments to cherish later on. Anyway, thank you all the students. And now, any feedback from our students or any feedback from our research scholars? Yes? Students?
I think, sir, there are hundreds of feedbacks they have posted in the chat box.
Yeah, I know.
Many, many.
Through some of them.
Yes, yes.
So let them speak. I would like to hear the students speak. So let them speak.
Okay, some of you, at least, please come ahead and say something. Yes. Students, please. Aditi, say something. At least, because you are the senior most at the undergraduate level. Sonia is there on at the postgraduate level, the senior most batch of the college department. Okay, so I'd like to request, first of all, Aditi. Yes, Aditi, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, say something. What you felt all these days.
Yes, Aditi, please.
Also, you have been there in the core group, that means in as one of the volunteers, and you also hosted our session on a particular day.
Yes, sir.
So you have a lot of experiences. Now say something on your experiences and say something what we can do for you later on.
Sir, no doubt this was a really wonderful experience. I loved the whole WebLex series very much. And to be frank enough, I was fortunate enough to be a part of this whole series. Even I hosted one of the lecture series, and I'm really proud of that fact. It was really tough. I felt very, I was really afraid before hosting, but my teachers really like helped me a lot, and they like encouraged me to take part in this. And not only me, our teachers have encouraged us all along. All through my college life, I can proudly say that our teachers were just marvelous, who taught us to speak like confidently. And whatever I'm telling right now, these are all the all the contributions of my teachers. And I don't think I need to tell anything about BCC and the English department and the teachers. Every one of us know. I will just tell that I'm proud of the fact that I belong to such a great college, and I have such wonderful teachers who stayed this wonderful web lecture series where we got to meet many eminent speakers. And I seriously don't want to name any of the teachers or any of the speakers, because each of them were just wonderful, and they were, listening to them was an experience. So I won't take any particular name. In short, I will tell that it was, everything was just marvelous. Thank you to the department, to our teachers, and to all the speakers.
Thank you, Aditi. And now from PG, Tathagato, Sostika, anybody? Sonia? Chandana? Anybody from PG section? Tathagato, Sostika, anybody?
Hello, sir.
Chandana.
No, sir, Sonia.
Sonia,
please. Yes, sir. Sir, we are very much enriched by this gracious enterprise taken by our teachers by this web lecture series on this pandemic situation, as we have been able to remain connected with a regular course of study. I would like to thank various research scholars, speakers and teachers and other members for enriching us in such a way. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sonia. And it has been our pleasure also to get connected with you every day for all these days. And we felt like classrooms every day, appearing before you and addressing you and inviting some of our colleagues or some of our students to host the sessions, to say something here. So a kind of routine activity that we have been continuing for all these days. And we at least got the charm of the flavor of the classroom. Okay, now anyone from PG second sem? Tathagata Swastika, anybody?
Yes, sir. This is Tathagata.
Okay, please.
Sir, the wave lecture series was extremely enriching and enlightening, and the research scholars were very helpful for us to give the lectures, and they were very much enriching for enhancing our knowledge, and we enjoyed the lecture series very much. And thanks to our department for organizing such a wonderful international web lecture series. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Tathagata. And anybody from UG 6 SEM? SEM 6? Anybody would like to volunteer?
Yes, sir.
Is that? Oh, Devapriya is there.
Okay, yes, sir. So, first of all, yes, sir, this is Devapriya. Sir, first of all, I would say that I am very much proud to be a part of this department, and I'm very much happy that I can participate in this web lecture series, and I also get the opportunity to host this program. And most importantly, I would like to thank all the teachers, all the resourceful scholars who gave their time and delivered such beautiful lectures, which really enriched us a lot. And really, it's a pleasure for us to attend all these lectures. And I will become very much happy if we can attend these lectures once again in future. And most importantly, sitting at our home, we get the flavor of classrooms by attending these lectures. It's really a great opportunity for all of us, I think. Thanks a lot once again. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Devapriya, for your for your encouraging words. And this is actually the inspiration that we receive, that we get from our students. Anybody else from UG SEM 6? Anybody? Priyanka, Sagarika, anybody? Or Somi, anybody from SEM 6, Vipassa, all are there. Vitali.
Sir, I think Dr. Suranjana Bhadra has joined, and she wants to share her feedback.
Okay, Suranjana, are you there? And yes, she is another resource person who has followed us all along, keeping aside, or rather putting aside, her household chores. Now, I'd like to request Dr. Suranjana Bhadra, Srirampur College, to say something.
Hello, am I audible?
You are audible.
Okay. I'm really sorry that I missed the first part of the session today because I had a meeting in my college over this Google Meet. So I'm extremely sorry. And as soon as Andhra informed me that the session is going on, this feedback session, I joined again. Okay, so anyway, I have been listening to most of the lectures presented here. And if I missed, I was always there in YouTube also. So apart from thanking you all, what I learned is how to organize such a work with the help of, by including the students, the entire faculty, the principal, and also I have learned how to work by seeing your entire venture. So not only that, I'm enriched by the lectures and all that is indeed something very good for all of us. We are all enriched by these wonderful lectures. And I have also learned how to organize, and I'm still learning. And I don't know whether I'll be able to ever in my life, whether I'd be able to organize such a kind of work with the students and the teachers and the entire lot. So you really need a great cheer from all of us, BCC. I would like to thank you extremely for this wonderful venture, And I hope that you will be able to satisfy us and the students and everybody more and more. So this is how the margin, as all of us, all the speakers here have said, that how the margin is actually teaching the center. Okay, so and here it's also in a forum where the margin and the center mixes or fuses together, and we all become one, and we also learn something that how we can be an inspiration to everybody. So thank you all. Thank you, the entire team of Bankura Christian College. We will be looking forward to more such experiments in this way. Thank you, Oyon. Thank you, Narugopalda. And thank you, my dear students.
Thank you so much.
Oyon, if I may interrupt, and that is why I have come back, is that I would also like to thank the technical support, which I did not when I was talking about. And the one who has, I don't know the name,
I will name him in the vote of thanks.
Okay. But the posters and the way the entire technical thing has been summed up, you know, that has really been one of a kind. So that is very important in an online session like this, to be technically equipped and to prepare wonderful, attractive posters, and every day informing people, reminding people in the Facebook and in the Messenger. So thanks to whoever has been behind all this thing.
Yeah, thank you, Antora. Actually, there are so many, I will name them, some of them. There was a team working there all the time, and our students have been just done wonders. And all the flyers, folders that you found, those were prepared by your students, not really by any other external support. No external support was there. Only our students did everything. Anyway, it is up to our head of the department to officially say thanks to them. Now, yes, anybody from UG SEM 6 to say something here? SEM 6, no. SEM 4, UG SEM 4. SEM 4, anybody would like to volunteer? Okay, then UG SEM 2. Okay, now anybody amongst the research scholars, if they are even now they are present, I would like to request them also to say something here. If our research scholars are present, or maybe our former students are present even now, or maybe some faculty members from other institutions, if they are present here, I would like to request them also to say something here. Okay, is there anybody?
Yes. Hello, sir, may I speak?
Who is that?
Hello, sir.
Please do.
Hello, sir.
Please do.
Am I audible, sir?
You are audible, Amrita. Please go ahead.
Okay. Sir, I feel like saying that it has been a very wonderful opportunity that I have got, and it was also the first time I have taken an active part of this international web series. Although I have missed the first some of the sessions for first few days, but later I have taken part in almost every web lecture series, and I felt very grateful to all of them, all of the those eminent speakers, and I have been I have learned a lot from this, and I must also convey my special thanks also to SB Mansuranjana ma'am, and I did enjoy her classes as if I had gone back to the master's stage when SB ma'am used to take our classes. Thank you, ma'am, for all and for all this, and thank you each and every respected teachers, and thank you, Oyon sir, also for providing us such a great opportunity so that I could take an active part in this first lecture series. Thank you all, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amrita. And is there anybody else from UG second SEM or fourth SEM? Otherwise, we will move on to the next session. That is
our... Sir?
Yes, who is that? Please introduce yourself.
Sir, this is Shomi, sir, from UG sixth SEM.
Yes, Shomi, please.
Sir, thanks a lot for organizing such a thought-provoking International OAB Lecture Series. It's my good fortune that I am a little part of our beloved department. What should I say about BCC or English department? It's not only a department. For us, it is an emotion, or better, it's our second home. We all consider it as our second home, and our department is our extension. Our teachers are glad to be up. What should I say?
I think our voice
is speaking. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Somi. Your voice was...
Sir, may I say something?
Yes, Mitali. Yes.
Yes, sir. This is Mitali from UG6M. Sir, really, it's a great pleasure for us. We are really blessed to be a part of this department. And also this International Web Lecture Series. So we are really thankful to all of our, all of you, and all of you, sir, not only teach us, encourage us to study, but you always encourage us to do us all kind of academic curriculum. Sir, বাংলাতে বলছি অনসা যেরম বলেন যে উনি ওনার টিচারদের কাছ থেকে শিখেছেন ওনার টিচার ওনাকে পড়ানি শিখিয়েছেন স্যার আমিও বলবো স্যার আমার ডিপার্টমেন্টের সব টিচাররা আমাদের শিখিয়েছেন পড়িয়েছেন অনেক আবার শিখিয়েছেন সবকিছু স্যার রিয়েলি উই আর গ্রেটফুল রিয়েলি উই আর ব্লেসড টু বি আ পার্ট অফ দিস ডিপার্টমেন্ট সো থ্যাংক ইউ
সো মাচ মিতালি দ্যাট ওয়াজ সো টাচিং
Now last one from UG second SEM, the junior most batch in the department, Madhuri Ma. To be the last hereafter, I would like to request our head of the department to officially support
us. May I speak something?
Yeah. Sir, am I on?
Yes, you are
on. You are audible, yes.
Sir, I think I'll be repeating almost the same things that already has been repeated. So, it's been a pleasure and honor for me to listen to such great personalities. It's really like a dream come true. And it would not have been possible if I were not a part of the prestigious Bankura Christian College. My college makes me feel proud every moment, so much that I literally brag about my college. I got the opportunity to listen to such deliberations and the way the teachers patiently and lucidly solve the questions that were being put forward by us is really wonderful. The way I was also given chance to host two of the sessions helped me a lot to gain experience and knowledge and also build confidence upon me for future. For this long 16 days, though we met through Google Classroom, though we met virtually, but felt nothing less than a classroom ambience. So thank you to each of the teachers. Thank you so much.
All the students, thank you. And
sir, may I speak something?
Who is that?
Please do. Please do.
Devi Kahaldar, okay.
Sir, I just want to say it was really an unbelievable experience. I just want to thank you all. Thanks to all my teachers. Thanks to the seniors. And on behalf of my department, I once again thank to everyone who joined and made it a grand success. I'm so much blessed to be a part of this lecture series and always be a part of BCC and especially a part of my department. Sir, want this kind of lecture series in near future again. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Okay, now...
Sir, may I speak?
Who is that? Bibasa.
Yes, sir. Vipassa, this is your sixth sem. So it was very much helpful for us. Thank you very much for organizing this international web lecture series, where we got so many eminent resource persons. I also thank COVID-19 also. If there is not there, we miss all these lecture series. So I'm very much proud to be the department also. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, this is Shreya.
Okay. Yeah, former student, please, Shreya.
Sir, I don't think that thank you is enough, because I always consider myself a part of this department, not like a former student. So I'm very much enriched and got this opportunity in the interactive sessions and listen to eminent speakers. I'm very happy, and I'm truly I've become energetic again to do in my own way whatever I want to do. So thank you to the department. It always feels like family.
Thank you so much. And actually, this sir, I know why wanted to thank this particular situation. Yeah, this is the situation. Definitely, it is this situation nobody wants, and it was unprecedented, and nobody would like to go for this kind of situation again in future. But the positive side that has come out of this is that we have found some such lectures where the students staying back at home could have got the opportunity of listening to such erudite scholars. This is definitely a positive thing coming out of that, and perhaps Vipassa was referring to that. Anyway, yes, any more response from anybody?
Sir, আপনার কথা ধার করেই বলছি স্যার, আপনি সবসময় বলে আসছেন যে কোনো সিচুয়েশনে সবকিছু যতই খারাপ আসুক না কেন তার পজিটিভ সাইডটা দিকে তাকাতে। আপনি কিছুদিন আগেও আমাদেরকে যখন গুগল ক্লাসে ক্লাস নিতেন আপনি সেটাও বলেছেন যে এই প্যান্ডেমিক সিচুয়েশন তাই কোভিড-19টা আমাদের কাছে অনেকটা সাপে বর হয়েছে। আজকে সেটা একদম সত্যি সত্যি সর্বত্রের সত্যি হয়ে গেল। বুঝতে পারছি কতটা এটা আমাদের কাছে, হ্যাঁ চাই না ইন ফিউচার এরকম কোনো ঘটনা ঘটুক, সবাই ভালো থাকুক, কিন্তু এই কোভিড-19 যদি না আসতো হয়তো আমরা এরকম একটা গ্রেট গ্র্যান্ড ওয়েব লেকচার সিরিজের সুযোগই পেতাম না। একসাথে এতজন এমিনেন্ট পার্সোনালিটিদের শোনার, ওনাদের আমাদের জীবনে এত অভিজ্ঞতা সঞ্চয় করার কোনো সুযোগই হতো না।
Thank you so much for your touchy words. Now, the last part of it, yet I know we have been waiting patiently for that particular session. And the entire team, those who have been working up all these days, whether as volunteers or as hosts or as what I would say, only as students listening to the lectures, the entire team was being led by our head of the department, Oyun Mondol sir. Now I would like to request Oyun Mondol sir to propose the vote of thanks officially.
Thank you, Dr. Narugopal Mukherjee, for giving me the chance. We have finally arrived at the very last juncture of the International Web Lecture Series hosted by the PG Department of English, Bankura Christian College. At the outset, I take the opportunity to thank the person who has been the chief motivator behind this 16-day-long academic exercise, the patron of this International Web Lecture Series, Dr. Fotik Boron Mondol, Principal, Bankura Christian College. Well, it is a happy coincidence that today is the Holy Guru Purnima. And I acknowledge with deep obeisance the contribution of the resource persons who have been our gurus academically, of course. I thank all our esteemed and revered resource persons, Professor Debnarayan Bondopadhyay, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Bankura University, eminent writer Kunal Basu, our highly resourceful international speakers, Professor Lisa Hopkins, Professor Deborah Cartmell, speakers beyond the state of West Bengal, Dr. Jibu Matthew George, Professor Shormishta Panja, Professor Prashant Kumar Das, and Dr. Richa Joshi Pandey, Madam. Two eminent principals who are excellent teachers, Dr. Shukriti Ghoshal and Dr. Indrani Dev. Professor Dipankar Sen, eminent joint DPI, Government of West Bengal. Professors from different universities within the state, Professor Aukshuman Kaur, Professor Nandini Bhattacharya, Dr. Shubhajit Sengupta, Dr. Arnab Kumar Sinha from the University of Burdwan, Professor Gautam Buddhashural and Dr. Sandeep Ain from Bakura University, Professor Nivedita Mukherjee from Sidhu Kanu Bishwa University, Purulia, Professor Himadri Lahiri from Netaji Subhash Open University, Dr. Nilanjana Dev from Jadavpur University, Professor Amrit Sen and Dr. Ananda Datta Gupta from Vishwa Bharati Shantiniketan, Dr. Oindila Ghosh from Diamond Harbor Women's University, Kolkata, Dr. Pradipta Sham Choudhury from the North Bengal University. I acknowledge humbly the contribution of a host of teachers from different colleges within the state, a senior teacher like Dr. Shishikuma Chatterjee, our ever gracious madam, Dr. Shorbani Banerjee, what to say about Dr. Antara Mukherjee, Dr. Suranjana Bhadro, and Dr. Shoykot Sarkar. Well, how can I forget my students? The hosts of the sessions particularly, who assiduously and quite deftly conducted the sessions, Tathagato, Shostika, Aditi, Riyanka, Shagorika, Devopriya, Bipasha, Shomita, Annesha, Subarna, Madhurima, Sudhi Sundar, Shayon. I acknowledge with sincere thanks the constant technical support rendered by Shantanu Mondal and his sister Tomosha Mondal in streaming our sessions via YouTube. I specially acknowledge, and this comes directly from my heart, the strenuous job of designing the flyers, posters, the detailed schedule undertaken by our artist student Abhilal Mukhopadhyay, our undergraduate SEM 4 student, and to some extent even by Shourab Dule, our PG student. In fact, I remember Abhilal bore things patiently and diligently, sometimes suffering the over-fastidious inclinations of his teachers. Kudos and cheers to Abhilal. I acknowledge and thank all faculty members from other institutions, research scholars, former students of our institution, students from other institutions, and one and everyone who have been present from day one over Google Meet or YouTube, who have actively participated in the interactive sessions and made all days of the lecture series scintillating, vibrant, and academically delightful. I thank, of course, the present students of my department, both undergraduate and postgraduate, for meaningfully contributing to the success of this lecture series by their august and vibrant presence every day. I particularly thank our office staff, Mr. Tonmoy Pal, who has helped the department in numerous ways for making this lecture series a grand success. I also thank Obhinavo Mondal, who made it a point to join the Google Meet Forum 40 minutes early every day and to make the presentation. He has been doing this for the last 15 days or so. Thank you, Obhinavo. On a lighter note, I thank both the Google Meet and the YouTube forums for being strong platforms to hold an international web lecture series of this nature. And last but not the least, how can I really forget the organizing committee of this lecture series? My colleagues, my senior most colleague, Dr. Ashit Kumar Bishash, for being a constant moral support. Dr. Naru Gopal Mukherjee, who single-handedly confronted many tantrums, and with perfectness undertook a huge, huge workload to make this lecture series really grand. Professor Shibojyoti Kormokar, whose sweet and charming personality in sundry little ways made this lecture series attractive and meaningful. My junior colleagues Shobhan Bandopadhyay, Moushumi Kundu, and Tapos Dash, who stood by the department to the best of their abilities, as they always do. Thanking you all once again, all whom I could name and all I missed out inadvertently. Wholehearted thanks on behalf of the Postgraduate Department of English, Bapura Christian College. Hope to see you again. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So let's call it a day.
Let's call it a day.
Thank you so much. Thank you, students.